Good evening, everyone. We are just about to start our topic, three mistakes that made my success. So we always speak about our success, but hardly speak about our mistakes. So today we are going to speak about mistakes, but that mistake made who we are. So the top, I think I would say the most inspiring personalities, the five personalities I know personally, are going to speak about their mistakes. Not only about their mistakes, but the mistakes that made who they are today. So as you all know, the five personalities are, one is DIG Ajith Rohana from police, Shiromal Khure, the CEO of Jetwin, Kasturi Chalaraja Wilson, Hema's logistics, so Hema's pharmaceutical CEO, and Sandra De Souza, Dialogue Chief Operating Officer for Customer Service, and Nista Kasim, you all know, the Chief Editor of Daily FT. So today they are going to be open and the mistakes they are going to talk about is some are personal, some are official, some are general. But all these mistakes has made who they are today. And if you have any questions, please ensure to put it on the chat and please ensure to keep your mics mute because this is a professional discussion. So we'll come to DIG Ajith Rohana because you said you have to leave soon. And so the question is general to everyone. So the first question, Ajith, goes to you. What is your first mistake that made who you are today? So I'm sure you must be having a lot of things, but the first mistake that made who you are.
So yes, you thank are. You very much, Sulo. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And this particular incident happened in 1983, when I was schooling. I went to this Saravanamuthu Stadium for Ananda Nalanda cricket tournament. So at that time, one of my friends, he gave me a cigarette. And I started that bad habit smoking since 1983. But I have given up that habit in 1995 after 12 years' time. And for a period of 25 years, I have not been smoking. But the smoking started in 1983. Then thereafter, I used to smoke cigarette, at least 5 to 10 cigarettes per day when I was schooling. Then what happened was this bad habit I practiced. And soon after my A-levels, 1985, 1986, generally my parents they didn't know about this and every time in the night after dinner at least I needed two cigarettes, so therefore I went to a bakery that was situated in the vicinity of our residence in my village. So one day in 1987 I went there. So as a habit, I go there because I inform my parents that so I'm going there to read newspapers. So this particular incident happened in somewhere in November 1987. A boy from our village, he came to this bakery and he said that there was a paper article that the police are recruiting police constables, and the paper article had mentioned that the application should be collected from the nearest police station. So this bakery was providing breads to our police station, I mean Koskama police station. So therefore on the following day the boy who was carrying all these breads to the police station, he had collected that application form and he had brought two applications. He said that the police constable in charge of the police station, he had given two applications, one application for police constables, but because that boy requested it, and apart from that, another application had been given to him by the police, that is for sub-inspectors. And the police had informed that if there are suitable I mean, qualified boys, so they can apply. That application was on the table, bakery table, for 2 weeks' time. So I didn't have any idea how to join the police. So then usually I go to this bakery for smoking. And after fortnight time, I thought that, so I didn't have any idea to join the police. So I was doing my, I mean, second spell, LL. Then, but finally I thought that, okay, so the application is there, moving here and there on the table. So I filled that application. And after that, so I was called for the interview. And after that, second interview. So fortunately, then they had selected me to the police as a probation sub-inspector. So I joined the police because of this bad habit, the mistake that I had done in 1983. So now I am a DIG of Sri Lanka Police, and I was the police media spokesman. So that mistake, I mean, that mistake created, invented a police officer.
Okay. Thank you very much, Ajit. So the mistakes of, I would say the mistake of that paper or the bakery has made you a police officer, finally. Okay, I'll come to Kasturi. Kasturi, if the same questions are, what is the first mistake that made who you are? What will be your answer?
I think the biggest mistake is me actually saying yes to this program. But this question is a bit of a, actually I can relate to it. So I, as a kid, as a teenager, every parent wants a child to be qualified. And I was one who didn't have any ambitions on qualification or careers, but wanted to do my sports. So the only way I could get qualified and repay my mother and make her happy was getting into university, right? So I got qualified to get into university to do physical science. I did double maths, physics, chemistry. Not that I wanted to be an engineer, but that's the only thing I was good at. And that time, because of the JVP issues, it was universities were closed. And generally, I'm a person, even in sports, I don't give up. I practice, I try to do anything within my control to improve. But when university started on the first day, I remember walking into the first English they had GELT or something like that. And I walked in dressed very, very docile with my hair plaited in whichever way and long skirt and all that. And some guy came, a tall guy, came and said, you, I am Mahendra. And so I looked at him and I looked behind and I realized it was for me. And that was it. I just gave up even without trying and I walked off. I didn't want to be ragged at all. So that mistake there is I walked away without trying. I walked away because I didn't want to try in an environment where I didn't have any control over. But that forced me to take something seriously. So I was auditing and I decided to at least make a career out of that and be qualified as an accountant purely because I didn't have any other option. So when this option was taken away, I focused on this option. And then that was my story of becoming an accountant and starting my career. So it started from a simple thinking of giving up without trying because I was scared of the environment around me. So that was the first mistake I think I can recall which impacted my life so much.
Okay, thank you. Yes, agreeing for a lot of things Sulochana asked is something that you all repeated and I'm loved for that. So I'll come to Nista. Nista, so when I asked you to take this, you asked me why you warned me because I said, every time you are being used as a moderator and no one is asking what is the secret behind you, about your success, right? So Nista, the same question goes to you. I think you may be having a lot of experience and normally journalists make mistakes. That's how the news comes out. So I want you to share because there are a lot of young journalists coming in. I think you are the best person to tell the mistakes are the news for today's, I think, media. So over to you.
Thanks, Sulo. Yes, I think you are in trouble. I come from a family of accountants and so obviously the pressure was to follow the father and the brothers and all that. So, and I also had a lot of, in my family, several went to the universities, but I was never studious. So that was a big mistake when I was young, because I wasn't studying and focused on sports. I had a slight passion, I mean, typical teenagers, you know, right, to be very expressive. And I tried a bit of journalism. That was, I was following radio journalism a bit. And then so it sort of being the a failed person in the family, sort of I thought I'll try this out and then develop the passion for journalism. So my mistake was not studying and ended up being a journalist, but it's not really a regret later on, but it is what I have become today.
Okay. So accountant made a journalist. Normally accountants never make journalists, but yes, as you said, thank you, Nista. So let me come to Shiromal. Shiromal, are you there?
I'm here.
Okay. Shiromal, now a bakery made a policeman, right? And Kasturi said agreeing this and all this has made coming to this. Then Nista said accountant background make a journalist. What was your mistake to make who you are?
Yeah, so mine was slightly different because my father had asked me to become a doctor when I was growing up because he wanted me to give free medication. Fidel Castro was his hero, so he wanted me to, like Fidel, give free medicine. So I grew up wanting to be a doctor, and but just 1 year into my advanced level class, when I had to cut frogs and rats, I just realized that was not my line. But maybe I'm by nature very, I'm not patient, I'm very impulsive. So I think if I stayed on, maybe I could have become a doctor, but I made the mistake of becoming very impatient and impulsive. And I told my dad, I can't do this. I'm not going to do this anymore. So there was no other option. Virtually overnight, I ended up, well, he said, well, the only thing you can do now is study the commerce subjects. And so then here I am, I became an accountant. So I guess not being patient and persevering in a particular field, just being impulsive, made me come into the business world.
Yeah. So accountant, the father, then the
doctor became an
doctor.
Accountant.
Okay. So if you look back, there are a lot of dreams, but finally you became someone else. Okay, now I come to you, Sandra, right? So Sandra, now everyone is having a story that they wanted to be someone, but by mistake they became someone. Now, I remember when you got the top 50 award, you said, no, I'm not into marketing. I'm not into IT. Now you are representing the technology, marketing and everything. So what was your mistake that actually made Sandra de Souza, if I may ask?
Okay, so, well, I decided, you know, to actually move from the marketing job that I was pursuing. I was working at a company that was very good at that. And at the period of time I was studying, I'm doing my CIM, and I was all set on a marketing career. And then I saw a great opportunity that came my way, purely not because it was an opportunity. I just applied to an advert that I saw, because in the company that I was, I didn't kind of like the challenges that I had being a you know, young girl in the early 20s. So to get away really from my boss, I decided I was just going to jump in and apply for another job and look for a job. And then I did get into a company that was the start of this career. I joined Celltel. Obviously, I joined Celltel to do a marketing job. And the consultants and the foreigners who were running or setting up Celltel at the time were very impressed, very keen. All of that happened. And I had the job. Once I went to the job, the foreign marketing consultants had left after a while, a few weeks actually. And then there were the local guys that were appointed. And those guys actually felt, and this is almost a laugh looking at a telephone, right? back then, 33 years ago, this telephone was looked at as a very, very technical thing. And then they said that there shouldn't be girls doing this job, especially a young girl in this job. It should be, you know, fairly mature engineering kind of boys doing marketing. And as a result, they gave me two options. They either asked me to leave or said, you know, you can sort of support and help and, you know, do a, like a support role. So there was nothing called customer service or anything at the time, 33 years ago. And then I kind of got into quite accidentally that role, which I didn't like. I actually hated it. Remember crying a whole lot and thinking like, am I going to leave this job? And then I thought, no, till I find another job, I won't leave. So I'm going to stay on and do this horrible whatever, you know, that I had to do. So really, actually, they didn't even have work for me. They let me be. I was paid salary, they let me be. So I started on my own, you know, trying to also still do marketing, sales, doing little presentations, helping out, taking inquiries, doing all kinds of things. You know, and then again, you know, the consultant changed. And then, of course, from the West, when there are people who come in, they have this idea about something called customer service, which Sri Lanka didn't have at the time. And then he said, you know, I think you're really good at this. Why don't you set up the customer service function for Celltel? And I gladly did that. So there I started my career. And really, that's how I got into the job that I'm in for 33 years. The only C-level, you know, who is in a customer service, service delivery kind of career, even in Sri Lanka. So I kind of, you know, through this horrible, horrible mistake, and I cried, I wanted to go away, I regretted leaving, I wanted to go back to my old job. And, you know, through staying on, I managed to, you know, set up something and make success out of my career. Sulo, we can't hear you.
Ajit, I come back to you.
Yes, Sulo.
Sandra, you're okay? You're done?
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
So coming back, so everyone was saying that they are the starting of their career and personal life. So I'll come back to the second question, because we always speak about mistakes related to the past. And now we are in a matured this thing, and sometimes some mistakes, there are mistakes that we cannot share. But if you look at our scars, are the things that has made who we are. So the second mistake is about your career. Ajita, starting with you because you of the timing. In your, if I ask you, Ajit, in your career, is there a mistake that helped you to found your realist competencies and strength? Because sometimes the mistakes we made in our career sometimes help us to find our, I would say, the promotions also comes with the mistakes sometimes. So what was your main mistake that made you from that bakery to the police, then the police to the OIC to the SSP, SSP and the DIG, and mainly now you are like, you know, you are a media person. I always say that you are a police officer, not actor. So I just want to know, what was your career mistakes that made who you are today? Over to you, Ajit. I think someone is not speaking. Okay.
Actually, it is not a completely career mistake, but this particular incident happened on the 30th of September 2000, 20 years back almost, when I was serving as ASP Rao. So on that particular day, ASP Valachana, he went on leave, and I was the acting ASP Valachana also. I came to Valachana at 3:30 to attend a function. And after that, by, I think, 5:45, I was leaving from Valachana to Irau. So we reach an area called Kiran on Valachana, Batiklo Road. There is a village called Kiran. So at that time, I was on a police vehicle, blue color Pajero police vehicle. So mistakenly, I mean, I was listening songs. I also am listening. So those songs, but I inserted the cassette piece. So those days we didn't have CDs, and even in vehicles we had only cassette recorders. So I inserted the cassette piece into the cassette of the vehicle, in a wrong way. So then the cassette did not work. So the song I was listening was Suvandathiya Malagopa Arang Yannaman. Then what happened was the cassette was not working. So I asked my driver to stop the vehicle, because there was a vehicle behind. It's a Pajero Jeep, belongs to the postal department, acquired to police on a temporary basis. So this then I got off the Jeep and I got into that particular private Jeep. Private means that Jeep belongs to the postal department. Then again we started. So after that, within 1 minute time, the vehicle that I was on board exploded. I mean, it was exploded by the LTT terrorists in Kiran area, and two vehicles were exploded. 13 police officers injured, and out of that, 4 police officers were killed in the explosion. So fortunately, I had a very narrow escape, but if I was continuing with that particular vehicle, so it has been completed almost 20 years after my demise. So therefore, then after that, after that particular incident, so I thought that I had a narrow escape and I need to serve the nation. I need to repulse the LTT terrorism. And I conducted several operations in that particular area. And I got the courage, and I'm continuing with that courage and enthusiasm.
Okay, so the cassette save your life because you put it in a wrong way, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I hope you won't do it again, because that bomb blast will not be able to save us. Okay,
now,
coming.
Now there are no cassettes, all CDs.
So there's only the CDs. Okay, I'll come to Sandra. Sandra, what was your career mistake that really got you to? Because now I think in your career, if there is anything about technology, customer care, IT, you are there. So what was your... A mistake or something you did it wrong, but it turned out to be something really good.
Yeah, so I would think an incident that I kind of remember is very early in my career at Dialog. I think it's almost after about 6 months after I had joined, right? So I came into Dialog after a 10-year career already in this field of technology, from the first company and then into the current Hutch now, which is a second company where I set up also these customer service operations. So when I came to Dialog, which was like the fourth entrant at that time, I had a lot of attitude. And I sort of considered myself very high and mighty. And, I wasn't really very friendly with everybody. And I was probably a little proud and so on. I tried to be also. After about 6 months, fortunately or unfortunately, I got sent away to South Africa on some assignment for about a week or two. And when I came back, things were very strange. It was very stressed. People were behaving very differently towards me and giving me these odd looks. And I was kind of trying to figure out what happened. Then finally, my PA told me, and a couple of other managers told me, that there had been a lot of complaints or whatever about me to the CEO and to the HR head. About me like playing favorites, about me being harsh, about me not being very accessible, and basically people didn't like me. So I had heard about this, and then my secretary said that she was interviewed as well and asked a lot of questions about me. So I was really very annoyed about this whole thing, and I went charging in to see my CEO and the head of HR then. And said, why did you go behind my back? You should have done whatever you wanted to while I was here. You didn't have to send me to South Africa to go behind my back and ask people about me. So then it was explained to me that I shouldn't look at it that way. And that really it was a learning opportunity, and that, you know, there are all these mistakes or gaps in my personality that I had to correct, especially because of the line of work that I was in, right? So I was so very insulted. I was so insulted. Even to this day, when I think about it, I'm annoyed, I get insulted. And then I think about, no, that made me who I am today. So I was so insulted that I made up my mind that I want to be, the best possible person that I can be in terms of being accessible, being loved, being friendly, being humble more than anything else, and trying to be there for people. Because I thought, okay, my career is also about helping people, then why should I be this way, right? I can't be two different personalities. So it took me actually probably another good 5 years of constantly thinking about it and working really hard at that, especially to be humble, right, and approachable. So, you know, the years roll by. I've now been at Dialogue for like 23 years. And I am happy to say that it's made me a better human being and a much, much better leader, because everyone acknowledges me to be the person I am. I'm friendly, I'm humble, I'm accessible. I always go out of my way. I think about others, I smile, I do what I can. And that more or less relates to the my career role as well. So it's made me a more successful, a leader. And I've always thought about now, in my recent years, I've always thought about servant leadership. I read a lot about it. And I think servant leadership is what's important. I was always inspired after reading a lot about Mahatma Gandhi, or whether it was Jesus Christ, what they were, or Nelson Mandela, what they were, Gandhi especially, was humble, approachable, and thinking about a higher cause and thinking about other people. So I'm just on this journey of trying to emulate that set of people and to want to be acknowledged as a servant leader.
Okay, great. So as you said, sometimes things which are happening to us make us angry when we are young, but that person is who you are today, because now you know what the regrets and all the pain you went through. You have decided, no, I'm not going to change. I'm going to change and treat the people the other way around. So that's one of the learnings from mistakes. So coming to Nista, I'm sure that career has made a lot of mistakes, but your paper has made a lot of success, and you are a person who I would say build careers for young people as journalists, because every time, but you get give a lot of opportunity for girls, that which I always appreciated. So what was your mistake on your journalism career that really thought of turning a point of journalism? Because you have turned a point in journalism, I would say. Okay. You have to unmute yourself, Nista.
Yeah.
Okay, right. Can hear Nista.
No, I'll answer this question in a different way. I have worked in about 5 newspaper brands in Sri Lanka, maybe 5 or 6. And being exposed to a mistake, I feel, and then by being exposed to the same mistake, I think I may have also done it. Generally, there's a tendency in print media to write or publish stories that you like, the journalists like. Right, doing the paper that I like to read, that has been the kind of general tendency from most across industry. What I did, I carried it over a period of years, and then when I started FT 10 years ago, we decided had a different approach. Yeah, the focus was more about publishing what readers want to see in a newspaper. This was based on feedback. And when, you know, we survived a decade when lots of other newspaper brands have failed or collapsed. I think that by learning the mistakes of the past and applying the learning, we have managed to stay relevant, be more effective, and also we get our readers to be more loyal by publishing a newspaper that they want to read, and not publishing a newspaper that journalists would like to read, but nobody, the market doesn't read, or they don't want to be featured, or they don't want to, there is no demand. So that explains the success, which I think I learned that having worked in all the newspapers in the past. I'm not saying other papers are not doing that, but I think if I were to talk about FT as a successful brand, I think that is the reason for to remain successful over the years.
Okay, so sometimes you have to take unpopular decision to make a mistake right and to find a way. So I think that's what it has been, and the media need that, and I think you have taken it. So I'll go to Shiromal, who is driving, I can see. Shiromal, I hope that, don't worry, since the DIG Ajitrohan is there, he won't be charging, so you will be not. Shiromal, if I ask you, what is the mistake in your career that made some success to you with your career?
Yeah, actually my Ajit is driving, so not Ajit Rohan, it's okay. I think my mistake was not towing the line when I was working in another company. I was working for an international company and as a finance director. So I found a couple of irregularities happening, and I told my boss what he's doing is not right and it should be corrected. But he wasn't really listening to what I said. So then I ended up telling my other boss, who was based in Hong Kong. I sent him a fax. Those days we had faxes, and saying this is what happened. But somehow my boss had intercepted that fax. And when I came home from lunch, my doors were locked and I was basically fired from the company. So that day I realized that it doesn't really matter. As long as I did what I thought was right, that gave me a lot of strength to do what I thought was right. But I was sad that the board of directors never stood by me. So I ended up without a job. And that is how I really started working for my dad. He found me at home and he said, why don't you come and join the company and work? So perhaps... that is how I ended up working for Jetwing, because before that I never wanted to work in the family company.
So when a door closes in another company, or when a life closes so many doors, there are so many doors are opening.
Yeah.
So sometimes a mistake or whatever happens, there will be people who will not stand by you, but there will be always someone who will stand to open a door. So that sometimes that's what life is all about. Shiromal, since you're driving, I'll go to the third, final question. Everyone talk about very happily about the career and other mistakes. In your personal life, what was the biggest mistake that you made, but it turned out to be one of the best mistakes you made in your life?
In what did you say? In your private life?
Yes, personal life.
Personal life, I guess I've made many mistakes.
Think about one thing that made you really happy about making that mistake.
That's a tough one, Sulo. I suppose maybe with my son, because he was fairly good in his studies and all of that, and everybody expected that I would make him a doctor or an engineer or one of those traditional jobs, or he would be pushed to come and join the business. But his passion is into singing and acting and that kind of thing. So sometimes I was wondering whether it was a mistake, because it's a tough life. It's a very competitive life. And I know he struggles and he's working really hard at it. But I'm happy that I allowed him to follow his dream and passion. So I could perhaps say that that's the one that I can.
Because someone will look at him and say, he's Shiromal's son and they are having so much of business and now he's singing only. But as a mother, you look at his passion. It's not about driving your dream. But for many, it's a mistake. But for you, it's the right decision. Am I correct?
Yeah. So, Sulo, okay, can I go now, please?
Yes, you can. Thanks. Because I don't want to disturb.
I'll come to Ajit.
Ajit, this is about personal life. There can be mistakes of your personal life, which you are happy about it, that you made it. So I just want to know, what was the greatest mistake you made in your life, in your personal life, and you are happy about it?
So I don't have any examples on that, Subham, actually. But I have another mistake that I have done, and finally it saved my life. Because in year 2009, five police officers, including myself, we had been selected to serve in the United Nations mission in Haiti. So our arrival date to Haiti was the 12th of January 2010. But then at that time, the IGP had sent a message to us stating that we should not proceed to the mission, and we had to wait another 6 months time. Then we went to his office, one day, and the others, they didn't talk anything, other four officers. But I had a heated argument with the IGP at that time. So being a SP, I thought that I should not do it, but it happened. So I was repenting that, because he was the head of the organization, and I should not argue in that way. However, so he did not allow us to go on the 12th of January 2010, and we filed a fundamental rights case, and finally we won the case, and we went. But if we would have definitely reached, if we had reached the Haiti on the 12th of June, 12th of January 2010, our scheduled time was 12:30. American Airlines flight was landing there. So definitely we were carried to the hotel that had been allocated for UN police officers' initial deployment. So on the same day at 4:30, an earthquake occurred in Haiti. 200,000 people killed in the earthquake. That particular hotel had been collapsed, and 800 UN police officers, police, military, they had been killed in the earthquake. So if we would have reached there, so definitely, several deaths would have been reported. So therefore, on the third occasion also, our lives, my life and other four police officers saved because of that mistake, because the IGP, because of that heated argument, the mistake that I had done, IGP did not allow us to proceed to Haiti. If we had gone there, so we would be banished.
Okay, it's so great that, you know, they say that men never speaks about mistakes on personal life because they have to go home, right? And women speak about their mistakes because even they go home, they will be the same person. So being that media speak spokesman and being knowing how to handle the legal side, you know how to put the question into the official, but I'll just leave it as it is, knowing you very well. I'll come to Kasturi. Kasturi, knowing you very well, and I want you to share something personal mistake you made, but still you feel that it has given you opportunities to be you who you are. So over to you.
Sulo, you're talking about personal mistake, is it?
Yes, personal mistake.
I can't call it a mistake, but it's a situation in my life given the circumstances. So as a kid while growing up, I love my dad and my mom, but my father used to drink. So you can imagine when you have a parent who drinks and the household, it has an impact. So imagine a kid who loves the father, gets confused how to express your love, because you see different sides of a personality. You see the father who's good to you, but father after alcohol is different to the other, to the mother. So I learned, I actually didn't know how to express my love to my father in words. I wouldn't tell it because I was confused, right? But when I grew, I realized I didn't know how to show it, because that's how I had dealt with it. So the thing is that very early on, I realized that that is something, even though I would do deeds, I wouldn't talk in words. So I think, and that's not naturally what I would want to be, but because you don't know what else, how to do it, and because you are so conflicted as a kid. So how I used it in the other sense is, when I became a mom, I'm very expressive with my kids. I would show a lot of love. I would tell them all continuously that I love them. I'll express, each time we talk, I'll talk about how much I love them and miss them. And even with my dad, I think I got a chance later on when he was older, and I relied on him to support me to bring up my kids. And he needed me. I guess I could yet express with deeds. I couldn't explicitly tell with words. So I guess the lesson I learned is, while people are leaving, I guess you need to deal with it and try to express what you feel. Because I was a kid growing up in this environment, I didn't know, and when I talk to kids who go through that, I totally relate to it. But I guess with age you understand, and as long as you acknowledge and put it in perspective, and you use, don't let that, you use another method of healing. So because of that, I'm an extra warm human being to the people who I really love and care, including my friends. I'll be hugging them and saying I love them. And so that's something personal. It's not a mistake. It's something I regret. I don't know how I could have been different, but I acknowledge that's something I wish I could have done differently in some ways.
So it's not, but unconsciously sometimes we do mistakes. So it's called unconsciously mistakes, that it's physically you're not doing a mistake. Actually, you are just acting, behaving what you are feeling, but inside you there is so that's why I think you are being so emotional, because I remember you always say I've become emotional, but I think that emotion is inside you, and that's who you are, Kasturi. Nista, I know you know you don't like to speak about personal mistakes, but you know, but you cannot say no, but some personal mistakes are so beautifully made you who you are, and I can say some of them, but I cannot say here. So if you look at your personal life and say something that, because that happened, I am Nista today, what will you say?
I can't recollect, but I mean, because I've been, Yandi has been my career, so it's almost personal, right? Okay, but I'll just tell you one which is personal to me, because when in one of the early stages of my career, I wrote a story about, Ajit Rono was talking about smoking. So there was a price increase in cigarettes by tobacco long time ago, 25 cents increase. So I was in the island at that time, and then I wrote a story totally miscalculating the impact, you know, of that increase of price will have on companies, profits and all that. And then we splashed it, and then it was a big embarrassment, because the company showed it to me how the story was wrong. So being a journalist, we always sometimes get the wrong facts, we get the wrong story, or worst has been wrong headline. So I think being a journalist right throughout, those were like big mistakes. But ever since that original experience of writing a wrong corporate story, ever since then I've become much more careful. But I'm not saying, you know, I'm still human. So I have made mistakes subsequently as well. So going forward, I might also make mistakes. But it's something that I always tell everyone to get your facts right. Look at, talk to people and first assess whether the story is right or wrong. So that's has been my personal, I still remember that incident.
Yeah, I remember the ones they said, those days, a pen can make a president or break a president, right? That was the media power those days. Now, as you said, if the facts are correct, I think a lot of things can be corrected, as you said. It would have been a very embarrassment, but I see you get all your facts correct now. With a lot of things, people trust Daily FT than anything. So that mistake has made that strong man, I would say. Coming to Sandra. Sandra, if I may ask you, because the bubbly Sandra, who you are today, right? And who is not scared to tell what you, when you see it, because you speak very forward and you tell whatever and you forget it also. So what was your one of the personal mistakes to make who you are, Sandra?
So I think you also talked about regret. So I think my personal biggest mistake, personally and probably regret also, is the fact that I decided to be this career woman and not so much a mom and a housewife, more the mom that I should have been, because it was convenient for me, because I had my mother-in-law in the house. She's brought up a lot of children, 6 of them, and then she also was bringing up a couple of other grandchildren of her daughter, another 3. And so when my daughter was born, oddly enough, I actually, you know, went back to work. I didn't even have to. She was born on Christmas Day. On the 1st of January, I went back to work. And then I also started going to work once a week or something. And then until about a month, and then my boss chased me out for a bit. So even during my maternity leave, I decided to go to work. So much so that I actually sort of wanted to wean the kid off and got on bottle milk, you know, I think in the first month. Unlike, you know, the way it should have been. And then thereafter also, I always said, my mother-in-law is a better mom. She's brought up 9, 10 children, so on. And I kind of always outsourced and never really, you know, I was so hell-bent on making a great career. I was never really bothered about doing all the things that usually kids would expect, like reading stories, like going to the park, like playing and, I don't know, whatever it is, especially cooking, maybe stuff and, you know, doing things. And that went on all the way till my mother-in-law passed away, and my daughter was in university, actually, when my mother-in-law passed away. And by then, she had already gone overseas. She didn't really need me also, I suppose, beyond that point. So that's something I kind of regret and I feel guilty about. I think I'll feel guilty about it for the rest of my life until the day I died. Because now I can't go back in time and correct all that at all ever. But because of that, I sort of really talked with my daughter a lot. And because she's an adult now and she's 26, she says, I completely understand that you built a career, you're successful, you are what you are. And all that made it also possible for me to enjoy everything that I had, you know, and go overseas. And I was such a spoiled kid. I had everything I wanted in life. More than I should have. And I understand that now. And she says, you have to really stop feeling guilty for it, mom, because, you know, it wasn't a mistake. But I said, no, I think it is and whatever. But she says to me that, yeah, I will do it a little bit differently having watched you, you know. And the fact of the matter is that I am an only child. And I decided I didn't even want to have another child because that was too much for me to handle, because then it'll get in the way of my career. So I decided to have one child also. But having grown older now, where my mom's also, you know, older, I realized that to be there for everyone all the time is much harder because you're one person. I mean, if there were 3, 4, 5 children, I see how families are mostly. There's so much to go around, especially for my mother-in-law in her, you know, she was nearly 90 when she passed away. My God, there were 5 children rallying around her almost every day. Every day there was someone. And for my mom, it's really hard for me to be there that way, to be present. And I feel the strain of, you know, not being able to cope like that. And I kind of regret, and I'm thinking, you know, when I'm older, and if I ever live to be 80, 90, it'll be so much harder for my one child who lives in Australia to be there for me. Whereas if there were 4 or 5 children, and if I had taken that trouble. So even when my mom says, you know, you're not there all the time, you know, and so-and-so's kids come to see them all the time? I said, yeah, that depends on the effort you put in. You had one child, so it's harder. You put in the effort to have five children, you'd have had someone come to see you every day. She actually compares herself with my mother-in-law and says, oh, you know, Rexy was so lucky. Every day, five children, they are all the day, all the time they're there. 7 days a week, somebody's there, right? So I said, yeah, but you didn't put in the effort Rexy did to have five children. You only put in one person's effort. But then looking at me, I've done the same thing. I put in one person's effort, which means, you know, when I get to older and if I feel like, okay, I have not much to do now, I really need time to spend with my kid, you know, it might be harder for her as well, right? So what goes around comes around, and you know, being a bit lazy, being...
Oh, I hope that it will not come around to you.
I certainly hope not. Yeah. But yeah,
sometimes when we are young, we speak about our careers and all that.
Yeah.
But when we grow old, when the kids are starting their own lives, then only we find that we need time with them, then they don't need time with us.
Yeah.
So I think it's a life circle of it.
Yes,
and that's what happening, because I do understanding, I'm going through that. So I do understand that. Saying that,
I have to say, Sulu, I don't think I'll ever get over. So that regret of, you know, not making the effort to have two or more, I don't think I'll ever get over it, because I can't make it right. And also the guilt I have for not being there when my child was growing up, I can't make that right either. So I'll never get over that either till I die. I'll have to carry those to my grave.
Yeah, sometimes some regrets are there that we have to carry with life. I think you are right. So, yeah, that's there. So thank you, because I think all five people shared their mistakes, and they look at those mistakes as, I think, yeah, there were some regrets, but they ensure that the present is something to learn so that the future can be changed. So the more we say that we only have to remember the pleasant things, the happy moments, but I would say the mistakes sometimes are teaching us something that we have to remember throughout our lives. So don't be they say it's okay to do a mistake at once, but if you repeat it, it's a crime. But if you repeat it differently, it's not a crime. That's what I say, right? So if you don't make mistakes, that means you're not doing anything, or not you're not learning anything. But if you're allowing yourself to make a mistake, you feel it's okay, it's our learning. But the best thing is, are you allowing someone you love to make a mistake and accept it? That is something we have to look at it. We always say it's okay for us to make mistakes. Are you ready to allow your spouse to make a mistake and ask forgiveness? Are you ready to allow your colleague to make a mistake and ask for forgiveness? A boss to make a mistake, a child to make a mistake, a parent to make a mistake. Think for a minute. We always speak about mistakes are the roads for success, but that's only for us, for selfish desires. But are we ready to let others to make mistakes for their journey? Tonight, I thank you all, and I'm sorry a lot of people has made requests to join, but we couldn't allow everyone to join. And this record will be on the YouTube and the Facebook. We try to give it live, then what we experienced last time was when you give live, there are a lot of chat, unwanted chat messages coming. And since this topic is, everyone was very curious, we ensure to have it on a secure thing and then record it and put it. So you can, if you have missed any part, you can watch it on YouTube or on our Vim Facebook. And I thank you all the five speakers for agreeing for my crazy topics as always. But remember, all my crazy topics has made a lot of people to learn about life. And I'm sure this also will be a learning. And thank you and good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Love the session.
Thank you.
Superb.